all of y'all who are watching online, we're so glad that you are able to connect with us. We recognize that not everyone is able to come out this morning, and so we're glad that you're here and that you're watching from wherever you're watching. You can be a part of the mission just by sharing that link on Facebook. You know, what's happening is happening here in Colony, but we know that it's our mission to make Jesus famous throughout the Capital Region. And so wherever you're watching from, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. We love you. Hey, you know what? We have added ambient mics. So now when you laugh at my hysterical jokes, it can be heard. So we can practice that right now. Yeah, that's good. That's good. But also when we applaud, we could hear that. So I'm wondering if we could just give a good Capital Church welcome to all who are watching online this morning. Welcome. We love you. Hey, would you take out your message sheets? In your weekly, you should have got a message sheet, and we don't do those every week, but when we do, I'd love for you to take that out and look at that. That will help you to follow along. It also gives you something to walk away with and to look at. Maybe throw me some follow-up questions later on in the week with that. We are concluding a mini-series on the Holy Spirit, and last week we talked about who He is. This week we are talking about what He does. If you missed last week, I encourage you to go online and you can watch or listen to that talk. Obviously, when we talk about who the Holy Spirit is, Holy Spirit's God, and we talk about what He does. I mean, He does many things, and so it's pretty, you know, it's pretty silly, if not pretentious, to imagine that we can talk all about what the Spirit does in one single talk. And so I'm not going to try to cover all of that, but there is one thing that I just think is the most miraculous, and the most productive. And the most powerful work that the Holy Spirit does in our lives. And so that's what I want to talk about this morning. This series, I think, is important for all of us, for everyone here in this room, because I believe there's many people who may be kind of in the place in their spiritual journey that a lot of Christians are in our world today. And it's not new. It's a place in their spiritual journey that we see even in the Bible, even in the book of Acts, we see some believers who are in this place. And what I'm talking about is in Acts chapter 19, there the Apostle Paul, he was a great missionary of the church, and he was traveling around the Roman Empire and planting churches and checking in on churches that were planted. And he goes to the city of Ephesus, and when he's there, he finds some disciples. And so these were Christians, these were followers of Jesus, and he asks them, he said, hey, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed, right, when you became a believer? And they answered, no, we have not even heard there is a Holy Spirit. Now, it may be that you wouldn't say I haven't heard that there's a Holy Spirit. You've probably heard that there's a Holy Spirit, or maybe, you know, depending on your Bible, you might have heard Him referred to as the Holy Ghost, one of those two things. And you may think to yourself, listen, I don't do ghosts, right? I don't even care if they're holy, right? That's just not for me, or whatever it may be. For any number of reasons, you may have in your spiritual life leaned back as opposed to leaning forward when it comes to the Holy Spirit. And you love God the Father, and you believe in Jesus, and you know that the Holy Spirit is with you somehow, but you have never truly received Him in your life, in the sense that you've never really developed any kind of vibrant, close, active relationship with Him, and maybe you didn't even know that that was even possible. But when we read the words of Jesus, we find that He believed not only that it was possible, but He believed that without that relationship with the Holy Spirit, that it's impossible for you to have a successful Christian life. That it's impossible for you to have a full and fulfilling Christian life without that relationship. And so it's important that we look into this and we discover what Jesus said and why He said that. And I think one of the things that kind of adds to the confusion or causes us to lean back rather than forward when it comes to the Holy Spirit is this one term that you may hear thrown around in different church circles, depending on what your background is from. And the phrase is baptism in the Holy Spirit. Ever heard that phrase before? Baptism in the Holy Spirit. Well, there's kind of a lot of confusion that goes around that. Today we're celebrating water baptism. That's what the hot tub's for. in case you were wondering, wanting to get in that. You can get in that, as a matter of fact. We have at least four people who are going to be water baptized today, but we want to open that up. If today you'd say, by the end of the service, feel compelled to be water baptized. Maybe you have put your faith in Jesus, but you have never publicly made that confession of faith with water baptism. We want to enable you to do that today. I know you probably didn't bring a change of clothes. That's okay. We did. We brought one for you. So we have in the Connect Center back there, we have a change of clothes, we have towels, we have toiletries, all that good stuff. It's all free. So you can go in at any time at the end of service, go and grab that and be a part of water baptism. Water baptism is an important part of the spiritual journey, but there are actually three baptisms that are talked about in the New Testament. Three baptisms, kinds of baptisms that are available to all of us. These are in your notes. And baptism, when we look at the biblical idea of baptism, it means to be immersed, right? So to be completely immersed. And one way to maybe think of it is like a bottle, right? Like a bottle of water. It's just a bottle, and the bottle is the container, right? And it's got water in it. But if you take this bottle and you immerse this bottle, it then, not if it doesn't fill up. When you immerse the bottle into the water, now the whole story changes. Now the water is the container, and the bottle is what's contained within it. Now when we look at the bottle, we look at it in a whole new context. We now look at it in light of the water that it's in. The water has become a new environment for that bottle. And maybe this will help you in a little way kind of understand the significance of each baptism. So the first baptism is this. I want to tell you about these three baptisms because all of these are available for you, and they're all a part of the spiritual journey that God desires and expects, intends for you to have. So the first one is the baptism into Christ. It says in Galatians 3 that in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. And so it's through faith. It's when you put your faith in Jesus. If you're taking extra notes, you can write down next to this, you can write down salvation. Because what we're talking about, we talk about baptism into Christ, we're talking about salvation. And so through faith, you come into a relationship with Jesus. And that's when we become true children of God. Because for all of you who are baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves with Christ. In other words, when you put your faith in Jesus, you are immersed. Your whole identity is immersed into Christ. It's kind of like Paul says, it's like you take on a whole new clothing. It's like you now have a whole new identity in Jesus. Your environment changes. See, when you get baptized into Christ, when you step into faith, Jesus, God, it's no longer just like an idea that's in your head. But instead, you enter into a relationship. Now, all of yourself belongs to Him. That's where your relationship with God really begins. Number two, second baptism is baptism in water. And we understand this, but a couple of things. Baptism in water is separate from salvation. Some people may tell you that you have to be baptized. First of all, that baptism saves you. That's not true. People will also say that some people will tell you that you have to be baptized or you're not saved until you are, and that's not true either. They're two separate things. Salvation is a work that Jesus did on the cross. We step into faith, into a relationship with God, a saving relationship with God, when we put our faith in Jesus. Baptism is something else. It's a public declaration of that private decision to trust in what Jesus did. In Acts 2, we read this. Those who accepted his message, and so that's, they believe, they were baptized into Christ by faith, right? They were then baptized into water, and about 3,000 of them were added to the church that day. There are 27 places in the New Testament where this is a pattern, so much so that we could almost call it instruction, where a person says, yes, I believe, and then immediately they go and they're water baptized, okay? And so we don't necessarily have that immediate baptism because, we don't live by a river. We do this three times a year, but if you want to be baptized, we will make that happen because it's this. You make your faith is a private decision, but at some point you got to go public with it. And so that's what water baptism is, a public declaration of your faith. The third baptism is this. It's called the baptism in the Holy Spirit, or the baptism with the Holy Spirit. Now, let me just show you how this worked for the disciples, and then you can kind of understand what Scripture suggests for us. So, you know, the disciples, they lived with Jesus, right? They lived with Jesus for 3 years. They heard all of his sermons. They saw all of his miracles. They ate with him. They knew him pretty well. But their salvation did not happen until after Jesus went to the cross and rose from the dead. Yeah, but all of those good works. Now, you see, before Jesus went to the cross, they were living under the old covenant. And that old covenant was based on their ability to stick to the law, which they were not good at, which none of us are any good at. But when Jesus went to the cross, he rescued us from that old covenant. He died to pay our penalty for sin, and then he rose from the dead. And when he rose from the dead, he established a whole new covenant that's now based on our faith in what he did. And so what we see is this moment, this post-resurrection moment with Jesus and his disciples. And it's great. John tells us about it. It's John chapter 20. Here's what we read. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for the fear of the Jewish leaders. So you're picturing this, right? The disciples are all huddled up and they're in a room and they lock that door good. All of a sudden, Jesus is standing there among them. And he says, peace be with you. Right? You think so, right? Like theologically, peace be with you was there. It was, I have now made all things right. But for them, it was like probably, hey, calm down, stop screaming. You're supposed to be tough fishermen, because he just showed up in the room right in front of them. All right, next slide. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. So he showed where the nails were, where the spear went into his side. He's showing them, look, it's really me. I'm the one that was on the cross, and now I've raised from the dead. And the disciples, when they saw it, they believed, and they were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. So the belief, that's where that belief began to happen inside. Next verse. And then again, Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them, and he said, receive the Holy Spirit. Now, this right here, this moment, is the disciples' salvation moment. This is their story. Here's where they're baptized into Christ, okay? So this isn't the baptism of the Holy Spirit yet. This is where they're baptized into Christ. And this is the same for us as well. The moment that you believe, the Holy Spirit comes to live within you. You may have heard people who tell you, like, no, you're not baptized, you don't have the Holy Spirit until you have the baptism in the Holy Spirit. That's not true. As soon as you put your faith in Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes to dwell within you. He marks you right then and there as belonging to God. He breathes life into your spirit, brings life to your spirit, and he begins to help you to live the life that you have been created to live. You all have, if you have put your faith in Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit, and get this, you have all of the Holy Spirit that you'll ever have once you believe. That's not the question. The question is, how much of you does the Holy Spirit have? And that's what the baptism is all about, the third baptism is all about. So same story, right? So this is John, right? This is a salvation story in John. Same story, Gospel of Luke. Gospel of John, Gospel of Luke. Very often they tell the same story, but they tell it from a different perspective. They add more details. And so when we read it in Luke, we see the same details. He talks about the locked door. He talks about showing the hands and the side. And then he says this. He says, I'm going to send you, just what Jesus said. He said, he says, I'm going to send you what my Father has promised. So in John, John tells us about how he breathes and they receive the Holy Spirit to indwell. And then Luke tells us how he pointed forward to something else that was about to happen. He says, I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city, Jerusalem, until you have been clothed with power on high. In other words, once you believed, you were baptized into Christ. You were clothed with Christ. You were given the Holy Spirit. But Jesus is telling them, there's more. You're going to be clothed with power. Book of Acts. Book of Acts was also written by Luke. This is right before Jesus is about to ascend into heaven. And he says this. He says, look, don't forget. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father has promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Look, you already have the indwelling Spirit. The Holy Spirit's already dwelling within you. but you've yet to be immersed in the Holy Spirit. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is a secondary experience from salvation. It doesn't happen at the same time. It's not the same as salvation. It's something more. And look at, here's the primary difference. Being baptized into Christ has eternal purposes for your soul. Being baptized in the Holy Spirit has earthly purposes. You'll see this in the next verse. Jesus, still same conversation. He says, look, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Why? And you will be my witnesses. In other words, when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you're going to receive power. In other words, when you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, what's going to happen is this. Your life is going to witness to the reality of who I am. See, the reason Jesus wants us to experience this, the reason he says, hey, there's more than just simply the Spirit indwelling, is that Jesus has a life for you to live. Jesus has a work for you to do. And that work, that life, is going to require a certain level of power. You and I can't do it on our own. Jesus came to give you life. The Spirit empowers us to live the life. This is what Jesus was telling his disciples on the night before his arrest. He knew that he was going to be returning to heaven soon, and so he wanted to prepare them for what it would be like to live as his follower, as one of his followers after he was gone. And so look at what he says to them. He says this. He says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. How do you feel about that verse when you read that verse? It's a little intimidating. I find that a little overwhelming, if I'm honest about it. Even a little bit embarrassing, because I don't know about you, but I tell Jesus that I love him all the time. But I don't keep his commandments all the time. This is such an important verse. I think it's especially important because we have to see when Jesus said this, he wasn't like gambling. It was like, maybe you'll keep my commandments. He's super sure of this statement right here. And in fact, I think this is such an important verse and important for us to understand this, because I think the way that you read this, it will impact, it will determine, define how you approach your Christian life. I don't think I'm overstating the importance of us to lean in to get this right here. If you've heard nothing else I've said so far, that's okay. Lean in to understanding this right here. This verse right here, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. That is in the English Standard Version. The English Standard Version is a translation of the original Greek. See that little ESV? Whenever you see that up there, that's saying which translation that's in. Now, if you were to read this same verse translated from the Greek, in the NIV, the New International Version, it says this. If you love me, keep my commands. Now, these are two very different sounding things, right? If you love me, keep my commands. It sounds like a command itself, right? It seems to suggest like, hey, if you really love me, then you prove that. You've got to prove that by keeping my commands. The ESV, it sounds a little bit different. The ESV sounds almost like a prediction or maybe a promise. Like, if you will love me, you will find yourself keeping my commands. So which is it? Well, it comes down to translating that word, that's that word keep. So in the original language, ancient Greek, the New Testament is translated out of ancient Greek. And so the word keep is the word that we need to look at. Now, you know, keep in English, if I want to say keep, I can say keep as a command, right? I would say like, hey, keep out, right? And we know that I'm not promising you something. I'm saying keep out. I'm commanding you to keep out. Or I can say it as a promise, right? Like if I want to promise you something, I can say it as a promise. Like I might say something like, if you like your health care plan, you can keep your health care plan, right? Something like that. That's like a promise that I would make to you. The New Testament, it was written in Greek. And the English Bibles have all been translated from that. Biblical Greek is a very complex language. When I was in Bible college, they forced us to take it. I took it for 2 years. And in 2 years, my teacher was able to help me to understand that it's a very complex language. That's kind of as far as I advanced. I can understand like what the squiggles are. I know how to pronounce them. I can put words together. You can put a Greek Bible in front of me and I can read it out loud, and you may think, wow, this guy can read, but I don't know what the words are. I don't know the word. I got about 50 word vocabulary in ancient Greek that I can read. But what I do know about, and what makes Greek so difficult, is that you can't take any of the verbs at face value. Every Greek verb has its own tense, voice, and mood. Just to make sure you're still awakened with me, will you say those three with me? Tense, voice, and mood. Every Greek verb has a tense, a voice, and a mood. And they change with the situation, and they determine how they are intended to be understood. Guys, you might say that ancient Greek is a lot like women. You know how you walk into the room and it's tense? Like you know how it feels right now, right? You walk into the room and it's tense. You know that you had better correctly read your woman's voice and mood, or you're going to misunderstand her meaning. You get what I'm saying? You guys are as bad as first service. Just leave me out to dry. No laughs, no yeah, amen. Just leave me there. Oh, he's hanging himself. That's fine. I will remember this. Anyway, Greek is like that, right? So we look at this word keep, and we need to understand this word keep. And its tense and its voice and its mood. Its tense and its voice and its mood is this. It is future, active, indicative. Okay? So what does that mean? Here's what it means. It's actually not super confusing. It means this. It means it's future tense, meaning that Jesus is talking about something that will happen in the future. It's like a prediction. It's like a promise. This is something that you will do. It's an active voice, meaning that obedience is always an action. It's not something that happens to you. Like, in other words, there's no promise that you're ever going to be in a place where God has, like, taken over your will, and now you're just automatically doing the things that God wants. Obedience will always be a decision, an act of your will. Obedience is active. And it's an indicative mood, meaning an indicative mood means that it's a statement of fact. In other words, it's not an imperative. An imperative would have been a command. Jesus wasn't making a command here. He was saying, look, this is the way it is. I promise you, if you will choose to love me, you will find yourself choosing to actively do the things I've asked you to do. Jesus is absolutely sure of this. Listen to how the Passion Translation has it. Loving me, I love this, loving me empowers you to obey my commands. Don't miss how important understanding this is. Jesus is saying, he's promising, look, if you will choose to love me, you will have everything it takes to obey my commands. If you will choose to love me, my spirit will work. He will begin to transform your heart to where you want to do the things that I ask you to do. You see, Jesus is saying, look, if you want to live the life that I've called you to live, then just fall in love with me. Focus on loving me. That's the order. You're not going to grow in your love for Jesus by trying harder to do things right on your own. You won't. You're going to end up just building up more resentment, or you're going to feel crushed by your inability to do so. And you'll just give up, or you'll become legalistic and judgmental. You will, however, willingly begin to want to do the things God asks of you as you grow deeper in your love for Jesus. Develop your relationship with Jesus. Fall in love with him. I mean, look at what good news this is. Jesus didn't come down to earth and pile on more rules and regulations. He simplified it. He's just love me. If you'll just love me, all the other things will flow out of that love for me. If you love me, you will follow my commands. How can he be so sure of this? Well, we see it because of the next, very next breath. He says, if you love me, you'll keep my commands. And the next breath he says, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you the helper. The helper is a term that Jesus used. If you weren't here last week, you can check it out online. It's a word that Jesus used to describe the Holy Spirit. It means literally that he will come alongside you. And so Jesus is saying the Holy Spirit will come alongside you to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth. And the world can't receive him, you see, because it neither sees him or knows him. It doesn't have a relationship with me, but you know him, for he dwells with you and he will be in you. The Holy Spirit empowers us to love Jesus. Verse 16, Jesus said, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. He's talking about the Holy Spirit coming to dwell within you. Yet in a little while, the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. And in that day, when the Spirit comes, you will know that I am in the Father and you are in me and I am in you. That's all immersion language, baptism language. Jesus is telling us the Holy Spirit empowers us to love Jesus, and that love is what enables us to keep his commands. Here's how Paul says it. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. He tells us this, that when you have the Holy Spirit in your life, here's what he produces. The fruit of the Spirit is love. I think the most miraculous, because I know myself, I think the most powerful, the most productive work that the Holy Spirit does in our lives is when he empowers you to love Jesus in a way that will change your heart about everything else and everyone else. One last thought. There's one question we haven't asked. And that's, what does Jesus mean by my commandments? Now, certainly if we were to make a list, it would definitely include all the things that Jesus said while he was on earth. But I think that he was being even more specific than that. Because you see, near the end of his ministry, he took all of the many different commands. He took them and he reduced them down all the specific ways that are the right ways to relate to God and to relate to yourself and to relate to others. He reduced them down to two commands. He said this. He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. And the second is, most important one is this, that you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus said, look, if you want to get this right, love God with all of yourself and love others to the same degree that you love as if they're you. Even later though, even more recent in this conversation, in this very same conversation Jesus is having with his disciples right here on the very night before he leaves, he says this to them. He says, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. He's saying, look, let me just make it even more simple for you guys. You will show love for God best when you are loving one another in the same way that I have loved you. You see, all the common theme in all of these things is that the Holy Spirit empowers us to love Jesus, and that love, it enables us not only to obey his commands, it also enables us to love like he loves. Now you can think about the people in your life. Understand the promise that Jesus is making to you. That if you will choose to love him, if that will become your priority, you will find yourself also loving your enemy. Think of those people that you might consider an enemy, those people who've they've done a lot to make themselves your enemy. Those people that are difficult to love, those people who don't love you back. If you will love me, you'll find yourself loving them too. If you will, if you will focus on loving me, if you will love me, you'll choose to love me, you will find yourself loving God with all of yourself. You'll find yourself loving your neighbor in a way that makes an impact. You'll find yourself loving each other in the way that I love you. And you'll find yourself doing all of those things that I taught you as well. All of those ways that demonstrate a selfless, sacrificial, radical, highest integrity kind of love. Does that seem difficult to believe for you? I just want you to tell you this. Jesus believes that's true of you. Jesus is absolutely sure that that kind of love is possible for you. And you know what? It's not because he thinks you're going to come around one day. He knows that we can't do it on our own. He knows that if we try, we're just going to grow resentful. We're just going to be defeated. He knows that we need an environment change. We need to be more than containers of the Holy Spirit. We need to become immersed in the Holy Spirit. We need to be led by, directed by the Spirit. So full that our actions and our words are the work of the Spirit flowing out of us. Well, how do we do that? How do we get baptized in the Holy Spirit? As I said last week, the Holy Spirit's like wind, the Holy Spirit is powerful. You may be thinking to yourself that this is not possible for you. But the power of the Holy Spirit is able to lift us to see what we can never see on our own. The power of the Holy Spirit is able to move us from where we are to where God wants us to be, as impossible as that may seem. But we also know the Holy Spirit is not predictable. There is no formula. So I'm not going to tell you how, three easy steps, how to get baptized in the Holy Spirit. And humbly, I would suggest that you run away from anybody who does have a formula for that. But I do believe that we can position ourselves, position our hearts and our minds in a way that doesn't seek to acquire more of the Holy Spirit, but instead allows the Holy Spirit to have more of us. Because it's in that position that the Spirit can then work that miraculous, powerful, productive work in our lives. So I'm just going to give you three things and then we're done. Number one, make the choice to love Jesus. To love, to obey, they will always be an active choice. It'll always be a decision of the will. We must make a decision of faith. If you're going to step into a relationship with God that's going to make any difference in your life and any difference in the world, it requires an initial decision of faith. And that's to turn away from your self-righteousness, right? Your idea that you can be good enough. It's to turn away from your self-sufficiency, right? That idea that you can lead your life well enough without God. Instead, to turn to Jesus and say, Jesus, I trust you to be the Savior and the leader of my life that I need. When we immerse ourselves into Jesus, we do that by calling on him in faith. And look, if you've never done that, if you've never invited Jesus into your life, you've never asked him to be your Savior, the leader of your life, you've never received the forgiveness of your sins, or maybe you have, but you've walked away from that walk, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that before we leave today. The truth is, no matter how far you've gone, no matter how far you feel away from God, you're just one heartfelt prayer away from inviting Jesus into your life and beginning a whole new relationship with God. That's number one, make the choice to love Jesus. Number two is this, ask the Spirit to help you love Jesus more. This is a simple one, right? It's just to ask for help. Sometimes that's not easy for us, but it's just to ask for help. It's to say, Holy Spirit, I'm asking you to help me love Jesus more. If you were here last week, you know, I gave you a prayer to pray. Holy Spirit, I want all that you have for me. Did you pray that this week? Holy Spirit, I want all that you have for me. Did you pray it when you woke up in the morning, when you went out to work, when you were at work in some conflict, when you came home, when you went to bed at night? Did you pray that prayer when you came in here today? Holy Spirit, I want all that you have for me. I want to encourage you to keep praying that prayer and add to it. Holy Spirit, I want all that you have for me. Help me to love Jesus more, because that's where it changes. When we love Jesus more, all of those other things will flow out of that love that we have for him. Thirdly, This is the tough one. Yield your will to the Spirit's influence. Look, as I said last week, like the wind, the Spirit can be resisted. You can make the choice to love Jesus. You can ask the Spirit to help you love him more. But what happens when the Spirit does begin to work in your life? What happens when he does seek to influence your life? What happens when he seeks to influence the way that you love your enemies? The way that you love your neighbors? What happens when he begins to seek, when he seeks to influence the way that you love God with all of your heart? Can he have all of your heart? Or are you resisting certain areas that you're reserving for loving other things? Things you know that God doesn't want in your life. What happens when the Holy Spirit seeks to influence you to love God with all of your mind? Can he have that? What about with all of your strength? All of your soul? When we talk about allowing the Holy Spirit to influence our lives, to love God with all of ourselves, can he have all of your sexuality? Can he have all of your finances? Can he have all of your ambition? Listen, to yield to the influence of the Holy Spirit, to yield, it means to give way to another. It means to surrender our way so that he can have his way. To live a life that's truly immersed in the Holy Spirit. And I'm not talking about a one-time experience. I'm talking about to live a life that's full of the Spirit. A life in which the Spirit's really leading you. In which the truth you believe is because the Spirit's guiding you into that truth. In your love for God, it's the Spirit who's directing that. In your love for other people, it's the Spirit who's directing that. To live a life that's truly immersed, a life that's empowered, to live the life that you've been created to live, to do the work that you've been created to do, to live a life that's truly filled and full of the Holy Spirit, it's going to require us to yield to his influence. Make the decision to love Jesus. Ask the Spirit to help you. Actively yield to him. If you will, Jesus is 100% sure that the Spirit will work in you. He actually, at the end of that, he says, be at peace. He says, I'm giving you peace. When I give you the Spirit, I'm giving you peace. If you will yield to him, he's promising you the Spirit's going to work in you. Those areas you feel like I'm holding back, I can't love this person, I can't obey that command. If you'll just focus on loving Jesus, the Spirit will work in you. He will transform you. He will make that happen. He promises. I want to end this way. The very first step into this is to be in a relationship with God. And that happens through putting our faith in Jesus. It's making that decision to love Jesus. And maybe you're here today and you say, listen, I have never received Jesus as my Savior. I've never received the forgiveness of my sins. Or maybe you'd say, look, I know all of this, but I have not yielded to him. I've not surrendered my life to him and asked him to be my Savior and the leader of my life. This morning, if you want to step into a real relationship with God, I want to give you that opportunity. I don't want you to leave today without that opportunity. That's a personal decision, like we said earlier. That's a personal decision. So I'm going to ask if no one would move around. We just sit still. Just keep this moment sacred for another minute. If you would bow your heads and close your eyes. I'm not going to make you stand up. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. Which I want to ask if this morning you would say, I want to invite Jesus into my life. I want to make that decision to love him. I want to receive him as my Savior and the leader of my life. I want to receive the forgiveness and have a relationship with God. Would you just raise your hand? And I'm going to see it and I'm just going to pray for you. Yes. I want to receive Jesus into my life. I invite him into my life. want to get right with God. Anyone else? I make the decision today. You can put your hands down. I'm going to pray. And as I pray, I'm just inviting you to pray along with me. And if you're a believer here today, pray along with us as well, so we don't have to pray alone. Jesus, thank you for loving me. I believe that you died for me, that you rose from the dead. And because you did, I have the forgiveness of my sins. And I can have a relationship with God. I trust you as my Savior, the leader of my life. Forgive me for trying to live my life without you. I ask you to give me your Spirit and help me to love you more. I surrender my life to you.